Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is the part two of my last lecture on eczematous disorders. Dermatitis and eczema of lower legs. Dermatitis of lower leg are subclassified as venous eczema, stasis dermatitis, and allergic contact dermatitis. So usually the eczemas on legs are of these three types. The lower limb venous eczema results from venous hypertension. Stasis dermatitis relates to the skin changes that result from reduced lower leg venous flow. So it could be any reason, maybe deep vein thrombosis or thrombosis of superficial vein or varicose veins. Then allergic contact dermatitis of lower leg is a common complication of both the two skin conditions, that is venous eczema and stasis dermatitis by the treatment which is given for these disorders. The incidence and prevalence. The combined prevalence of venous eczema and venous stasis is estimated to be 3% and 11% of the population. So venous stasis is more common than venous eczema. Venous eczema patients are usually middle-aged or elderly, and there is an increased incidence of female patients. Predisposing factors of lower leg eczemas are previous deep vein thrombosis, obesity, immobility, and previous cellulitis. The venous eczema may develop suddenly or insidiously. The venous eczema and stasis dermatitis are both erythematous, scaly, and often exudative, and usually are seen around the ankles and lower leg, mainly on the medial aspects. The eczema is often accompanied by other manifestations of venous hypertension, which include dilatation or varicosity of superficial veins, edema of the legs and ankle, surrounding purpura, hemosiderosis, and ulceration, or small patches of white atrophic telangiectatic scarring, that is atrophy blanching. So usually the background skin in patients of venous eczema or stasis dermatitis is not normal. Complications and comorbidities. Allergic contact dermatitis is one of the complications of venous eczema and stasis dermatitis. And such eruption present a sharp linear cut off patches, which are matching to the application of topical therapy, wound dressing, or compression hosiery. Secondary infection is common. And if cellulitis occur, patient may experience pain and increased skin temperature and swelling. Then lipodermatosclerosis may develop and venous ulceration occur for a disorder that is of long standing duration. Investigations. Ankle brachial pressure index, called as ABPI, is required prior to consideration of compression hosiery. For example, if the ankle brachial index is more than 0.8, it indicates suitability for graduated compression bandage. If this pressure is less than 0.8, it means that the flow in the leg arteries is slow or less. And in that cases, the compression hosiery will have a bad effect on the leg. So, compression hosiery, whenever it's advised, it is also always advisable that ankle brachial index should be measured. Management of venous eczema or stasis dermatitis is any underlying venous hypertension or pedal edema should be controlled surgically or medically. Obese patients should be urged to lose weight. Well-fitted support stockings can be helpful if worn regularly. So the well-fitted means that appropriate size should be given. Too tight or too loose, compression hosiery will not have its effect. The leg should be elevated as effectively as possible, especially when retiring to bed. Mild topical steroids may be used to relieve irritation, but the use of potent corticosteroids should be limited to short periods. Topical tacrolimus has been reported to be effective. If patient cannot resist scratching, then paste bandages like zinc paste or urea paste is helpful. Then dermatitis and eczema of eyelids. Eyelid is a common site of atopic eczema. Seborrheic dermatitis may also be associated with eyelid eczema, especially when there is mild dandruff on the eyebrows and eyelashes. Contact allergies to various components of eye makeup, to nail varnish, to various fragrances, rubber and ophthalmic medications can also result in eyelid eczema. Eyelid eczema is also common as a part of airborne dermatitis because of the particles that are embedded in the air like dust and pollens. Management. When condition is not amenable to removal of the cause, treatment with mild corticosteroids like hydrocortisone is usually effective. Topical immunosuppressants like tacrolimus can also be particularly useful in this area. 0.03% should be prescribed initially, and if not effective, then can increase the strength of tacrolimus to 0.1%. Juvenile plantar dermatosis is a unique kind of dermatosis that is characterized by shiny, dry, fissure dermatitis of the plantar surface of forefoot and tend to spare the non-weight-bearing instep. This is typical to diagnose the juvenile plantar dermatosis. The toe clefts are normal, and this helps to distinguish it from tinea pedis. The symmetry of lesion is a striking feature, that is, lesion is present on both the feet. So mainly occurring on forefoot and sparing the non-weight-bearing areas and occurring symmetrically. It is common in children aged 3 to 14, and occasional cases are seen in adults or in infants. There is slight preponderance in male children. Association with atopy have been proposed, but it is not convincing. Occasional cases have occurred in children wearing open leather sandals and suggest that friction and enhanced sweating may play a part. Most cases will clear spontaneously during childhood or adolescence, but condition may persist into adulthood. The first line treatment is change to leather footwear and cotton socks rather than open sandals. Emollients including urea containing preparations. Then in severe cases, Lessar paste, tar containing preparations and tacrolimus or other keratolytic like salicylic acid can be prescribed. Usually this condition is not associated with itching and is only a discomfort, so we don't need any topical corticosteroids for the cure of this condition. Infective dermatitis. Infective eczema is the eczema that is caused by microorganisms or their products, and that by definition clears when the organisms are eradicated. It is not always clear how much of eczematous change is due to the repeated scratching, secondary impetigo, or direct response to the infestation. Patches of eczema that occasionally develop around a lesion of molluscum contagiosum or around an infected wound provides a good example of infective dermatitis. Bacterial antigens can promote a cytotoxic reaction in the skin, but this is perhaps more likely to aggravate or perpetuate than to initiate the eczematous process. So the eczematous reaction can occur as an allergic reaction to fungal infections elsewhere in the body. There are two terms which are used. One is the infected eczema and one is the infective eczema. And you need to differentiate between the two terms. The infected eczema is actually the infection, bacterial infection of already existing eczema. And it shows erythema, exudation, and crusting. The margin is characteristically sharply defined, and there may be small pustules in the advancing edge. So the infected eczema is the secondarily infected eczema. It can be atopic, it can be a hand eczema, it can be an osteototic eczema. So any eczema can get infected and it is called as the infected eczema. Then infective eczema, as we have explained it before, is the occurrence of eczema surrounding an infection, which could be a bacterial infection, like an infected wound. It could be a viral infection, like molluscum contagiosum, or it could be a fungal infection, like Tinea pedis. And this eczema is secondary to the infection. While infected eczema, eczema was primary and infection was secondary. In infective eczema, the infection was primary and eczema is secondary and present as area of advancing erythema, sometimes with microvesicles and seen around the discharging wound or ulcers and seen around Tinea pedis. And even infective eczemas are also seen in pediculosis and scabies. The treatment letter includes treatment of the primary cause, ulcer, etc. Topical antibiotics for mild presentation and systemic antibiotics with potassium permanganate soaks are given if this occur on hands or feet. So once the infection is treated, then the eczema is automatically treated. So we don't need to give any product for this infective steroid product for infective eczema. Infective dermatitis in children is associated with human T cell leukemia virus 1 infection. Since the heading explains everything, so this is another cause of infective dermatitis in children. Post-traumatic eczema. It is rare for the eczematous dermatosis to demonstrate the Kobner phenomena. However, this may occasionally occur. So Kobner phenomena is not a typical phenomena in eczema, but it does happen that eczema develop at site of trauma in individuals who have no past history of eczematous dermatosis. And eczema also develop in burn scars. P. alba. P. alba is a dermatitis that is characterized by round, oval, or irregular hypopigmented, mildly scaly patches that are not well marginated. Some erythema is usually present in early cases, but it is mild and hardly noticeable in most of the patients. In 20% of affected children, neck, arm, and shoulders are involved, as well as the face. Less common, the face is spared. So one thing is important, that this dermatosis is a dermatosis of growing children. And secondly, not only the face, but neck and shoulders are involved. So sometimes it is mistaken with petrosis versicolor. The hyperpigmentation is most conspicuous in pigmented skin, and in lighter skin, it becomes obvious when the skin is tanned due to sun exposure. P. alba occurs predominantly in children of both sexes between 3 to 16 years. Average duration of common facial form in childhood is an year or more. So it may take a long time to get cured. P. alba is more common in children having atopic dermatitis, but it is not a mandatory association. Sometimes among the differential diagnoses, we are confused with vitiligo, with nevus depigmentosis, nummular dermatitis, and very rarely mycosis fungoides if it is involving the trunk. There is some role of sun exposure as well. So in the treatment letter, the first line is use of a broad spectrum sunblock and mild emollients to counter the dryness of the skin. If not cured, then mild topical corticosteroids are used. And third line include topical tacrolimus or pimercolimus. Chronic superficial scaly dermatitis. This is a chronic condition that is characterized by round or oval eczematous, slightly scaly patches on limbs and trunk, which histologically show mild eczematous changes. The condition was formerly included in various potentially pre-lymphomatous eruptions under the journal term of parapsoriasis. The term chronic superficial scaly dermatitis was introduced to distinguish a group of patients who did not progress to frank lymphoma and having a benign disease. The onset is in middle age, much commoner in men, and rare in people with darker skin type. Histology is parakeratosis, mild spongiosis, and slight perivascular lymphocytic infiltrate. Clinical features include that the disease begins as insidiously with one or more erythematous and slightly scaly patches, hardly noticeable and rarely having any symptoms. Leg, trunk, and arm is the most affected site. It seldom involves face, palm, or soles. Patches are generally round or oval, but finger-like processes are also common, especially on trunk, which gave its name the digitate dermatosis. There are other causes of digitate dermatosis, which include ingestion of shigatake mushrooms and by bleomycin. The individual patches are often slightly wrinkled and appear like cigarette paper. Symptoms are minimal and some itching may occur. They remain static with minor fluctuation and persist throughout the life. And few patients' condition clears permanently. So differential diagnosis include nummular dermatitis, eczematides, and poikiloderma in early phase or early stages of mycosis fungoides. So if such type of lesions are present for a long period of time, then they must be biopsied to rule out the patch stage of CTCL. Treatment is by mild emollients or mild topical corticosteroids, or sometimes we go for phototherapy like narrowband UVB or PUVA. Dermatophytides. This is a reaction at a remote site to a dermatophyte infection elsewhere. The diagnosis should be suspected when presence of a dermatophyte infection has been established, while no fungus is demonstrated in the dermatophytoid lesion. The diagnosis is supported further by clearing of dermatophytoid after the dermatophyte infection is cured. Various clinical patterns of dermatophytoids can occur. Commonest is on hand, like eczematous vesicles or Pomphylex-like reaction that occur in reaction to Tinea pedis. The dermatophytoids may also mimic P. rosea and erysipelas-like dermatitis, erythema nodosum, erythema annular centrifugum, urticaria, and erythroderma. Halodermatitis. Halodermatitis is an occurrence of eczematous rings surrounding a melanocytic nevus. Histologically, the benign nevus is surrounded by dermal lymphocytes and eosinophilic infiltrate. The condition usually resolves spontaneously within a few months without involution of the nevus. Similar changes are not infrequently seen around seborrheic keratosis and is called as the Meyerson phenomena. So the halodermatitis can occur around a benign nevus. Histologically, it is characterized by infiltrate of lymphocytes and eosinophils with mild spongiosis. It is cured, but the nevus stays behind. This is different from the halonevus, in which as the halonevus advances, the nevus is gone. And similar condition surrounding seborrheic keratosis is called as the Meyerson phenomenon. The Murray-William warts are multiple seborrheic keratosis that arise in a few months following resolution of eczema and to generally resolve by 5 to 6 months. Lichen simplex and lichenification. Lichenification is the coarsening of skin surface marking on a background of dry and erythematous skin associated particularly with long-standing pruritic dermatosis. As the condition progresses, skin becomes thickened and hyperkeratotic. Lichenification may occur spontaneously. Then it is called as the lichen simplex. The peak incidence is in middle age, 30 to 50, and women are more commonly affected. Patients with lichen simplex are more readily conditioned to scratch following an itch stimulus. So the itching stimulus is more, and patients are inclined to scratch the areas. In predisposed subjects, emotional tension play an important role and ensure its perpetuation. So good psychotherapy is required in every patient who presents with lichen simplex. Clinical features. Lichen simplex, single or multiple sites are involved. Commonest sites are those that are conveniently reached. The usual site are the nape of the neck, lower leg and ankle, vulva, pubis, and scrotum. Lichen simplex of the nape of neck is called as the lichen nuki and confined to women. There is a descriptive term which is called as the pebbly lichenification that consists of discrete smooth nodules and papules, usually in atopic and seborrheic subjects and in photodermatitis. And clinically, it may simulate lichen planus because of their papular nature, but Wickham's trials will help in differentiating between the two. The management. First is the patient education and psychotherapy. Second line is potent topical corticosteroids, including impregnated adhesive tapes. Then zinc paste bandage for limbs or intralesional triamcinolone for solitary lesions. Erythroderma. Erythroderma is the term that is applied to any inflammatory skin disease that affects more than 90% of the body surface. So erythroderma may be the initial presentation or more commonly arise in context of a long-standing eczema. So a long-standing eczema can turn into erythroderma, or erythroderma can start as the early or first presentation. It is common in middle age with slight male predominance. In acute stages, parakeratosis, spongiosis, dermal edema, and non-specific inflammatory infiltrate is seen. And in chronic stages, acanthosis and elongation of rheti ridges is obvious. These are the causes of erythroderma. Common cause conditions causing erythroderma include eczema, which comprises of 40% of cases of erythroderma. Then psoriasis account for 25% of cases of erythroderma. Lymphomas and leukemias account for 15%. And drugs, which include phenylbutazones, phenytoin, carbamazepine, gold salt, lithium, and cimetidine, account for 10% of the cases. Unknown causes are 8%. So as we see in from number 1, 2, 3, 4, the main causes of erythroderma are eczema, psoriasis, lymphoma, and drugs. Rare causes include hereditary disorders like ichthyosiform erythroderma or pityriasis rubra pilaris. Then pemphigus foliaceus in 0.5% of the cases. Then other skin diseases like lichen planus, crusted scabies, and dermatomyositis. The rare causes of erythroderma include sarcoidosis, Hailey-Hailey disease, pemphigoid, toxic shock syndrome, lupus erythematosus, angioimmunoblastic lymphadenopathy, dermatomyositis, graft versus host disease, and erythroderma following seroconversion with HIV. Clinical features. Erythroderma often has a sudden onset. There is patchy erythema initially, which rapidly generalizes and may be accompanied with fever, shivering, and malaise. Hypothermia may develop. Scaling appears within 2 to 6 days and often first in flexures. At this stage, skin is bright, red, hot, and dry. Irritation is sometimes severe, but sensation of tightness is more characteristic since almost all of the skin is involved. When erythroderma has been present for some weeks, scalp and body hairs may shed and nails become ridged and thickened and may also be shed. Lymph nodes are usually slightly or moderately enlarged and of rubbery consistency, but sometimes the enlargement may be gross. This adenopathy, lymphadenopathy, is called as dermatopathic lymphadenopathy and should not be mistaken for lymphoma. Papilloerythroderma of Fuji is a variety of erythroderma which differs from ordinary erythroderma that it typically begins with an intensely itchy eruption of brownish red, flat top papules that become confluent. So as the name signifies, it is the papilloerythroderma. So it presents as brownish red papules which become confluent. Limb and trunks are mainly affected and tend to spare the face and flexures, which is another differentiating feature from the usual erythroderma, because the normal erythroderma involves the flexures and face. A characteristic and distinctive pattern of sparing of abdominal flexures is termed as the deck chair sign. Additional features include hyperkeratosis and fissuring of palm and soles and benign lymphadenopathy. Occurs later in life and mainly in males. Histology is non-specific. However, in epidermis, there is generalized mild degree of acanthosis, spongiosis, hyperkeratosis, and focal parakeratosis. There is marked perivascular lymphohistocytic infiltrate with eosinophilic predominance. So this is a feature which is distinctive from other forms of erythroderma, that is presence of abundant eosinophils in the perivascular infiltrate. There is circulating eosinophilia and raised IgE. Reports of papilloerythroderma occurring in association with malignancies, including T and B cell lymphomas, gastric, lung, colon, prostate, and hepatocellular carcinomas. And in terms of prognosis, papilloerythroderma typically persists for many years, although some cases have remitted. Management is by emollients, topical corticosteroids, antihistamines, and sometimes oral prednisolone. PUVA, including bath PUVA, prove effective in several reports. Then sometimes we have to go for immunosuppressives like azathioprine or cyclosporine and itritinate. Retinoids or phototherapy may be preferable to immunosuppressants. Complications and comorbidities of erythrodermas in general. The main complication of erythroderma is the hemodynamic and metabolic disturbances. Blood flow through the skin is markedly increased because of inflammation, and this can result in high output cardiac failure, especially in elderly patients. The increased skin perfusion leads to loss of heat causing hypothermia. And there is a fluid loss by transpiration and loss of albumin due to increased protein loss from the exfoliative scales. This results in peripheral edema. Erythroderma is potentially a fatal condition. Current mortality rates are probably lower, but erythroderma still is dangerous in elderly people. Cutaneous, subcutaneous, and respiratory infections are common, and pneumonia may be a cause of death in many patients. The most frequent form of erythroderma, including the eczematous psoriasis or unknown origin, which continues for many years and often have a relapsing and remitting course. So patients who are prone to develop erythroderma, maybe because of eczema, maybe because of psoriasis, tend to develop erythroderma again and again. Management, first line is hospitalization or day unit admission, withdraw or switch medications that may be implicated as a cause of erythroderma. Monitor and correct loss of homeostasis, including temperature and fluid balance. Treat the secondary infection and frequent application of greasy emollient. The second line therapy include the systemic therapy for the underlying cause. For example, if it is eczema or it is psoriasis or it is lymphoma, then treat the underlying cause. Systemic corticosteroids should be avoided for erythroderma due to psoriasis because withdrawal of steroids will result in conversion of the erythroderma to pustular psoriasis. Then the last topic of today's lecture is the seborrheic dermatitis. Introduction and general description. Seborrheic dermatitis is a common relapsing dermatitis that is characterized by erythematous patches with superficial scaling, and these scales are little oily or wet scales. It affects the areas with high density of sebaceous glands, namely scalp, face, central chest, and anogenital region. If isolated to scalp with little or no overt inflammation, it is referred to as dandruff or pityriasis capitis. Pruritus is variable. The cause remains unknown, but commensal lipophilic yeast of genus Melassezia, previously known as Pityriasosporum, is a main contributor nowadays. Epidemiology. Dandruff has been estimated to affect up to half of the world population post-puberty. Majority of studies have found that seborrheic dermatitis is commoner in males. An infantile form of seborrheic dermatitis is recognized, which is called as the infantile seborrheic dermatitis, but there is still a debate as to whether this is a distinct entity or a variant of atopic eczema. So many a times it is difficult to separate the early occurring atopic eczema from seborrheic dermatitis. The prevalence of seborrheic dermatitis is higher in patients with human immunodeficiency virus, HIV, and human T-cell leukemia virus, HTLV. The prevalence of seborrheic dermatitis is also increased in patients with chronic neurological diseases like Parkinson's disease. Pathophysiology. The connection between fungi and seborrheic dermatitis was first proposed in 1874. So the proposal is very long and very long, has a pretty long history. Removing the organism with antifungal agents leads to remission of seborrheic dermatitis. Advances in molecular diagnostic techniques have led to identification of 7 main species of Melassezia, and recent observations suggest that Melassezia globosa and Melassezia restricta are the more common associated species. An increased secretion of lipases and phospholipases have been shown in vivo in patients with seborrheic dermatitis. This leads to formation of oleic acids, which impairs epidermal barrier function and causes desquamation of scalp skin as dandruff in susceptible individuals. Seborrheic dermatitis is reported occur more commonly in winters and reported to improve with sun exposure. Clinical features. The onset of seborrheic dermatitis is usually in early adult life with localized inflammation and superficial flaking of the skin. The complaint typically runs a chronic relapsing course. If involving the scalp, it usually the inflammation does not extend the hairline beyond the hairline. Facial seborrheic dermatitis typically affect the cutaneous folds like nasolabial, ear creases, eyelids and glabellar areas and medial eyebrows. Involvement of scalp ranges from mild flaking without underlying erythema to more inflammatory eruption with thick yellow greasy scales and crust. Similar changes occur in the beard area. When this loose debris fall into eye, it results in conjunctival irritation and red eye. On torso, several forms of seborrheic dermatitis occur. That is petaloid or petal-shaped lesions, large flexures, glazed and pink petrosiform variant is seen. And anogenital involvement may occur in both sexes. Infantile seborrheic dermatitis. The patient present mainly with cradle cap or with neck pin dermatitis and usually appear by the age of 3 months and disappear by the age of 8 months. Additional involvement of eyebrows, paranasal areas, large flexures is present. And this is of considerable help in differentiating it from atopic dermatitis. Widespread seborrheic dermatitis may rarely evolve into exfoliative dermatitis with erythroderma. Differential diagnosis, sebo-psoriasis have been used to describe the psoriasiform scaling in seborrheic dermatitis distribution, but it is not a clear identity and should be avoided. Allergic contact dermatitis may mimic or complicate seborrheic dermatitis. Perioral dermatitis also affect the nasolabial fold, so it also mimics the seborrheic dermatitis, pemphigus foliaceus and pemphigus erythematosus. Any bad type of seborrheic dermatitis or infective form of seborrheic dermatitis should be differentiated from pemphigus foliaceus or pemphigus erythematosus. P. rosea may mimic the petrosiform variant of seborrheic dermatitis. Drugs that produce seborrheic dermatitis like eruption are sulfhydryl group of drugs, that is captopril, d-penicillamine, gold sodium thiamolate, lithium methyl dopa, chlorpromazine and cimetidine. These are almost the same drugs that causes erythroderma. Differential diagnosis in infants include Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Langerhans cell histiocytosis also present as greasy papules in seborrheic distribution, but most of them are having purpuric lesions, and patients or children have other systemic complications and failure to thrive. So it is easy to differentiate Langerhans cell histiocytosis in a young infant from infantile seborrheic dermatitis. Acrodermatitis, dermatitis enteropathica mainly involve the periorificial areas and Lienhard's disease. Pediculosis is also common. Seborrheic dermatitis is characterized by the perifollicular psoriasiform hyperplasia. So the main brunt of the disease is surrounding the hair follicles. Parakeratosis is present on either side of the follicular ostium. That is parakeratosis and parakeratosis on either sides. Seborrheic dermatitis, there is parakeratosis and neutrophilic and neutrophils are present. The neutrophilic exocytosis in cases of eczema is typically seen in seborrheic dermatitis. So here you can see The column of parakeratosis in cases of seborrheic dermatitis. Management. There is no definitive cure of seborrheic dermatitis. Long-term maintenance therapy is required, but some patients use treatment intermittently for acute and symptomatic flares. So it is very important to explain to the patient that seborrheic dermatitis should not be taken as a disease, but should be taken as modification in the few habits of the patient, which one of them is use of frequent shampoos. Range of topical agents may be used and systemic therapy is rarely indicated. The keratolytic agents like urea, propylene glycol, and lactic acid reduce scaling and inhibit growth of fungi. Topical antifungals are mainstay of therapy that include 2% ketoconazole, cyclopyroxolamine, zinc parathione, selenium sulfide, and coal tar. These are available in various formulations such as shampoos, lotions, cream, and foams. Topical lithium gluconate has anti-inflammatory effect in seborrheic dermatitis but is rarely used. Other treatment options include 4% nicotinamide cream and metronidazole 0.7% gel. 0.75% gel. Photodynamic therapy with indole-3 acetic acid. For infantile seborrheic dermatitis, short-term treatment with moisturizer containing licorice derivatives. Coconut oil is also used. Topical corticosteroid may be used in combination with antifungals. On delicate sites such as eyelids, topical calcineurin inhibitors are emerging as an effective alternate in inflammatory cases. Oral antifungal therapy is occasionally advocated for recalcitrant and widespread seborrheic dermatitis. Since the offending agents are the yeasts, so azoles antifungals must be used and not terbinafine. Itraconazole is most frequently reported treatment. Twice daily oral preparation is given for twice daily for 5 to 7 days. In small open reported cases, a small open report study, narrowband UVB is found to improve seborrheic dermatitis. In vitro studies of modified synthetic antimicrobial peptide P5 found that this to be 3 to 4 times more potent against Malassezia furfur than ketoconazole. So this is a new thing. So I thank you all for a patient listening. And hope to see you next week with another edition of my lecture. So goodbye and have a good day.